Hello, friends of the radio. Again, we come into your presence thanking you because you have decided to come along with us today. We feel that we need you every Sabbath to come along with us to pray the prayer of faith and to help us to sing the songs of Zion, because God is still on the throne and He still inhabits the praises of His people. And the more that we can have to praise the Lord Jesus Christ, the better we feel. We know that what He said, where two or three were gathered together in His name. We realize that. But to us, numbers mean souls. I know that the book of Numbers is in the Old Testament, and I know that the book of Acts, what we do, is in the New Testament. I know that. But yet to me, numbers represent souls. And I love to look at television programs when many come to seek the Lord for salvation. There may only be one out of ten, or according to Matthew, the 13th chapter, maybe only one out of four that will get it. But praise God, if there's only one gets it, that is something that's worth a lot, isn't it? Can you say amen just to know that one soul has accepted Christ? That you can know then that He is still on the throne, that He's a making propitiations to the Father for us, that we have an advocate with the Father, even Jesus Christ the righteous, whenever we do fall back into what we call sin. Oh, I know it makes a lot of difference whenever we're saved, that we have an advocate with the Father, even Jesus Christ, and He is still making propitiation for you. Praise the holy name of the Lord. Now, in a few minutes, we're going to be looking at Jonah, the second chapter, and the 10th verse, just in a few minutes. We'll be speaking on spiritual dyspepsia this afternoon, and just want you to bear with us and to help us to pray, because this is something that really behooves us to study and to know more about, is this spiritual dyspepsia. And I know that that is something that you don't want to be entangled with. It's something that I don't want to be entangled with, is spiritual dyspepsia. But praise His holy name, we don't have to be if we'll just sell out to the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you sold out? Thank God, because that you are. Hallelujah. Thanking yous again who have sent in offering. And this past week got one from a faraway source, one that I know right well and love. And it was a wonderful offering. It was a help, a big help to keep the radio program going. And we just want you to know that Jesus loves you even more so than I do. And I think that I love you a lot, those of you who have contributed. Now, especially your prayers. That's what we're thinking about, is the prayer, praying people, the prayers of the praying people that go with us from week to week. Hallelujah, that goes up the stream of time in the gospel crusade, that we can just worship Jesus all together. You know, the distance doesn't make any difference, because Jesus, well, the Spirit of the Lord circumscribes this entire earth, and I'm glad that He does. Praising His holy name. Now I'm going to be looking down here at the second chapter of Jonah and the 10th verse. It says, "And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land." You know why? Because Jonah had an unfinished task. A task that he was unfinished, and a task that he should be about the Father's business. But he was a running. Instead of running for Jesus, or running for Jehovah, rather, he was running from Jehovah. Listen, folk, it's a poor way to have, and a poor thing to have your back turned to the Lord. It's good to be facing Him. And if we're facing the Lord, then we know as we move forward that we are moving on toward Zion. Are you in that group that's a marching to Zion? Oh, I'm so glad that you are. I know how you feel. If you're tuned in Sunday afternoon, when many folks are going to visit Grandma and Grandpa, some are taking naps, others are watching sports programs, others are watching something else or visiting But you have tuned in the radio this afternoon. It shows me that you are really interested in the Lord. Hallelujah, and I'm glad that you are. Now, this afternoon, I want to hear a little word, a song from Brother Tom and Sister Ned, maybe a little exhortation from Brother Tom upon an unfinished task. Praise the holy name of the Lord, yes, upon an unfinished task. And have you ever thought about the unfinished task that the Lord has got for you? I'm sure that you have.
Five.
Praise his holy name.
This song is entitled An Unfinished Task.
If I can
he ever saw. They had a truck pulling a U-Haul trailer. And it had the exclamation on it, "I took it with me." But I think that the rich man would have a little something else to say to him. What the rich man wanted was to get back and tell his five brothers that where he was at was a terrible place to go. Let us try to be sure that we don't leave behind any unfinished tasks. Make sure that our mansion in heaven is finished, and that we can come before the Lord and lay our sheaves down in front of him and say, Lord, this is what I've done for you, and hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant.
Praise the name of the Lord. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Oh, I'm so glad that there's such words as that in the scriptures. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Is that what he's going to say to you? Is that what he's going to say to me? Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Or could we fall into sin in such a way? I know that you can't be unborn, but you can die. There's such a thing as dying a spiritual death. And I just wonder if we will be found faithful, that he won't say, depart from me, for I never knew you. I know this Lord of ours, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. I was in a chiropractor's office, and a woman by the name of Alexander in Jerseyville, and he threw his arms around me. It takes him a while to preach. You know, he's so full of the Lord, and it does me good. It's a lift. You know, I believe that that's one of the things. I believe a doctor could lift us a lot higher if he would just give us a little sermonette every time that and say, I love you, I love you. That's what Jesus is trying to say to us today. I love you. It said again, and the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. Here we found a man, Jonah, who wasn't running for the Lord now, but as we said a while ago, he was running from the Lord. And while he had his back turned upon the Lord and running from the Lord, and was towed overboard into the sea. And when this big fish swallowed him, I know over in Matthew they called it the whale that swallowed Jonah. But when this big fish swallowed up Jonah, that he didn't even make good fish food. He wouldn't even make good food for a fish at that time. He was in such a stinking mess because that he had turned his back upon God, upon the great Jehovah, and this fish had to finally take him and cast him up, vomit him, cast him upon dry ground. Oh, yes, that was one way. He got free transportation then. He may have paid for his transportation before when he was going the opposite way. But this time he got free transportation. But it was after he had been in hell. And as I've looked this up, and it talks about Sheol, where he said, I cried out of hell. That meant that his spirit was in the place of departed spirits. We talk about Lazarus being dead for 4 days. We talk about Jesus being dead also, or he gave up the ghost anyway. And here we find Jonah. He was the same way. And if you have a dictionary or a concordance of some kind, a Strong's or some kind of like that, that you can go to, you will find out that hell has been translated Sheol, the place of the departed spirit. I don't mean queber, a grave where man places another's body. I don't mean that he was dead. He was dead. That was Jonah. But God brought him back to life in a new way. Hallelujah. That does something, folks, to us when we get that new birth, doesn't it? We get that new birth, then we are willing to listen to the Lord. I know that fish had what we call dyspepsia. He couldn't hold that down. He couldn't hold that body down any longer, and he had to get rid of it because it was making him sick. That fish got all so sick that he had a vomiting spell. And have you ever got that sick to have a vomiting spell? I want to talk a little bit about it in the spiritual, about that well. We'd call it spiritual dyspepsia if you wanted to call it that name. That place where the food keeps wanting to run up the throat, that you can't digest it right. It's one form of indigestion. I realize that too. It's that type that comes back up instead of going on through. That's what we call spiritual dyspepsia, is when we get something in the Word of God or hear it and we can't just digest it. That's what John, in the sixth chapter of John, where Jesus was talking to him, and he says, "And except ye eat my flesh and drink my blood, ye have no part in me." And they said that's an awful saying. They'd been going with him and had a big meal. They digested that meal in the natural. But when it come down to it, down to the fine points, when he was going to try to get the spiritual side of this allegory over to them, they could not accept it because they said it was too big a thing for them, and that would cause them to vomit up the whole thing. Solomon said, "Hast thou found honey, my son? Eat what is sufficient for thee, lest you vomit the whole thing up." And that's one of the things that we do with kids, isn't it? We only give them a little bit of candy because we don't want to make them sick and see a vomiting spell and losing everything that they've had. And that's what we want. We want to keep down what the Lord gives us to digest, to be able to keep it down in our system. I know that a few members of the church and myself was called to the side of a man here this past week that had the natural dyspepsia because he says, "I'm hungry," but he said he couldn't keep anything down, and consequently they was giving him the IV treatment to give him some strength, and yet he wouldn't be vomiting it up. And that's the way it is in the spiritual also. If we can't get it down one way, maybe we can get it down another. And if we can't see the Word, can't understand the Word ourselves, that we can go to someone and have some consultation with them, someone who does believe, someone who has had trials of his own and knows what to think of, what the thinking is in the one who has a dyspepsia, because maybe he had a little trouble of his own, and we can counsel him and show them that there is such a thing as digesting the Word of God. That we can have more of them like Ezekiel and like John. They can digest the Word. They can be fed the Bible, can be fed the book of the Lord. Hallelujah. And you know what he told John? He says, "John, as it goes down your mouth, it'll be sweet. But," he says, "when it gets in your belly, it's going to be bitter." And how many times we take that today. Maybe I know that my father-in-law, I've talked to my wife, has told me about it. In days of old, when they was growing up, that her father, he liked to give them ginger, and he would put it in capsules for them, and they could take it down and didn't burn their throat, but it wasn't long till they could feel the heat and the burning in the stomach. Now, I'm not going to say that was any good. I'm not going to say what it done. I'm not a doctor, and I haven't had the experience myself, but it didn't burn as it went down, but it did after it was there. And that's what the Lord told John. That's what the angel told him. He said, "Listen," he said, "it's going to be sweet in your mouth, but when it gets down to your belly, it's going to be bitter." There's one thing that I don't like to eat, and I can tell you that right real quick, and that's spinach. I don't like the spinach that you get, and if you're in the hospital, that's one of the things that they're going to feed you. I don't think too much of it, but yet I guess it is good. It helps to balance the diet, and that's one of the things that's wrong with us today, is the balancing the diet. We like to go to Sunday school and give the Lord 1 hour a week of our life, and to listen there where we can ask questions and where we can discuss it ourselves, and when the hour of Sunday school is over, then we're ready to leave. That's not right. Let's get a balanced diet here. Let's stay and hear some of the Word of God. Let's help to sing some of the songs of Zion, and we'll find out that it will be a cure for spiritual dyspepsia. you'll find out that it's a lot better to keep well than it is to get well. Because after you've once had anything like that, you're always afraid. And I've seen things that's in the church that has caused others to vomit. And what I'm talking about is spiritually. And I'm not going back over some of the things, but he has said signs and wonders would follow. And I have seen it in the church when the church was believing God. I've seen that back around 59 and 60 and 61 back in that time. And yes, and maybe in 57 and 58 ahead of that, I've seen the miracle oil. And many people have vomited at that. They could not stand it. But praise God, I could see that it was from God myself. I could see it. And I'm still like this. It didn't make me sick. I just said, God, I'm glad that you're in the midst and help us to stay in the midst. Yes, we want to keep a balanced diet if we can and maybe cure up some of this spiritual dyspepsy. It's not only going to Sunday school on Sunday morning. It's not only that, but it's also at home being able to read the Bible at night or in the morning before you start to work and to have a word of prayer with the family. That'll help us a whole lot if we can just keep that balanced diet there and have exercises in the Lord. When would you think that we should have the exercises in the Lord to cause this dyspepsy to vanish? Well, there's two times, as I've heard Brother Paul Elliott say, there's two times to worship the Lord and to get this exercise in our system, and one of them is when we feel like it, and the other is when we don't feel like it, that we can go ahead anyway, and we can praise the Lord. We may not be able to feel the results, but we know one thing, that God will honor His word. Glory be to God. And I sometimes I think, as I read 2 Corinthians 4 and 10, that Paul is writing to, I said 2 Corinthians, I meant 2 Timothy, that Paul is writing to Timothy there, and he said, Demas has forsaken me because he is got hungry for the world, not the word, but the world. And he was turning his back upon what he had learned. He didn't have the spiritual dyspepsy while he was listening to the word of God and seeing the miracles that God was doing through Paul. I'm sure he didn't have it then, but when he would turn his back upon the word and let Satan and the evil ones pour the illicit word into their being, into their soul, then they would get hungry for the world again. Oh, no, don't let us turn our back upon God and get hungry for the world, but let us stay hungry for the word. Praise God. I sometimes think about Martha. She said to Jesus, said, yes, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. She also said, and I know, that whatever you could ask for, and he would be raised again. Said, I believe that. Said, I believe that whatever you'd ask the Father, that the Father would do for you. And finally, you could see the faith in her heart, or you thought you could, until Jesus says, roll away the stone. She said, oh, no, Master, he's a stinking now. And her faith was stinking in the grave with Lazarus. Oh, she'd said it. And then about the time that the Lord tried to prove that her word was right, then she got the spiritual dyspepsy and said, it can't be. It can't be. Yeah, how about it? Is the word that you've been feasting upon, is it still in your soul? Are you still running on it? Are you still navigating for the Word of God? To put out the Word of God, if you're a Sunday school teacher, you need it more than just a regular lay member. If you're a Sunday school superintendent, you need it. You need that faith to be building up every week, not only upon the Sabbath day, but the other 6 days in the week also. That can just continue to build up in your life, that God can do with you what He would like to do. And when God can do with you what He likes to do, then you will be more intimate with Him. You will receive the blessing from on high, and you will be able to hear him say upon this earth in your heart in that still small voice, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Remember old Elijah, when he felt like running, when he felt like throwing his hands up and saying, "What's the use?" The angel come to him and fed him, said, "You eat this, Elijah." And it wasn't long thereafter that said, "Elijah, you're not a glutton, but you better eat another meal. You better get more of the Word of God down in your soul. Get more of it down in your heart right now, because you're going to need it. You're going to need to go a long way." And that kind of word, listen, dear one, won't cause spiritual dyspepsia when it's a word that comes from heaven. That is not spiritual dyspepsia. Praise God, I'm glad that Jesus is on our side. Oh, well, I'm glad that we're on Jesus' side, if you want to phrase it that way, which is better. I'll tell you one way to get rid of spiritual dyspepsia, and that's to pray to God that he will cause you to want to assemble. I remember back in 1956, yes, I can remember back that far, when we was going to church at Carrollton. Praise God, the Assembly of God in Carrollton. And we would leave Walkerville to go. And yes, we'd have church on our mind. But there was several times when we got to Belltown, just about 4 miles out of Carrollton, we could just begin to feel the Spirit of God meeting us. Yes, if I wanted to phrase it parabolically, I would say we could smell the food, the aroma of the food in Carrollton when we were that far away. Yes. Do you say, "Now that's all hogwash"? No, because we could actually feel it, and we was a growing in the Lord. And you know that there's a time when you're young, that young child will want to eat more so than the grown up. Well, we was that way then. We was young in the Lord, and when we got that close to church, we could just feel it boiling up in our soul. Oh, that's a wonderful feeling to know that you're going to come in contact with the Spirit of God with others, and don't know what's going to happen. We don't know what will be a cooking, but we know one thing, that Jesus will be there. Praise the holy name of the Lord. He will be there. And if we're two or three are gathered, and if we are in line with him, if we've got our thoughts and our life lined up with the Spirit of God, we're going to feel him. Father in heaven, I'm thankful that we can have food for our soul that won't run up our throat, that we won't have the spiritual dyspepsia. Lord, that we can keep the food down that you feed to us. Lord, that we can be like Ezekiel and eat the Word. We can be like John and we can eat the Word. Lord, and we know one thing, when we eat it and it's fed from the heaven above, it's not going to run up our throat, Lord, but we can have the Word to study and to know that we are able to pray for lost souls and for empty lives, that they can be saved and they can be filled in the sweet and lovable name of Jesus. And for his glory we pray, amen and amen. And until this time next Sabbath afternoon, this is Evangelist Garland William returning you to your announcer.